on the podcast from Final Draft. This is the podcast where we talk about screenwriting, filmmaking, and everything in between. I'm your host, Phil Galasso. Today's guest is Kerry Ehrin, showrunner of The Morning Show, now streaming on Apple TV+. Starring Jennifer Aniston, Reese Witherspoon, and Steve Carell, the show is a behind-the-scenes look at the challenges faced by the people who work in morning television. Kerry and I discussed her approach to writing complicated characters, her experiences working on shows like Friday Night Lights, Parenthood, and Moonlighting, her advice to young writers, and more. Check it out. Well, Kerry, thank you for taking the time to chat. For our listeners who are maybe not familiar, can you tell us what the morning show is?
The morning show is, gosh, that's a big question. I wasn't prepared for it. It's it's Apple's show. It's a new show for Apple. Premiered last fall. Stars Jennifer Aniston, Reese Witherspoon, Steve Carell, Billy Crudup. The list goes on. And it is about behind the scenes at a morning news show.
Was there? So this was Apple TV Plus. Apple TV Plus is first big show right out of the gate. So yeah. Can you talk a little bit about, I mean, I'm sure there was some pressure there. What was it like, you know, taking on something like this where you're launching a streaming service?
Well, it's terrifying pressure. I mean, I think one of the things that you slowly get your body used to doing this job over, you know, 30 years is anxiety. You start out feeling like anxiety is a wrong feeling. And then by this point in your career, it's like part of lunch. So I think that yes, it was huge pressure. It was huge anxiety. That aspect of it was not fun, but I also tried to not dwell on that. I tried to just live in the fictional world because we had to do so much so quickly and figure out so much so quickly about this world and the characters and the story we were telling that I really just lived inside the fictional universe as much as I can. And that kind of protects you in a way from the anxiety because it's a separate part of your brain.
One thing that I really enjoyed about the show, and I think it's something that I, you know, looking at some of the other shows you've worked on, like Friday Night Lights, is the characters feel real and the relationships are messy and nothing, you know, there's a lot of gray area. And I'm just wondering if you could talk a little bit about that because, you know, yeah, that's a really interesting, there's a lot of interesting character work and interesting drama there.
Well, I mean, that was that's sort of my sensibility. It's one of the reasons I loved Friday Night Lights, as a show to just be a writer on. It was because it was a very messy universe. It was, you know, people who are struggling and desperate, and there's good and there's bad in everybody. And that is just part of my sensibility. So when I was thinking about this show, I really wanted to look at that. And I really, when I write, I break down the psychology of every character. So I understand like their basic psychological and emotional blueprint and what they want and what they didn't get and what they need, what they're trying to get, what they're fucking themselves up and not going to get. So that's really like the main component really of my writing. So of course I approached this that way as well. I wanted to look at all the different permutations of the situation. And it is much more interesting to me to tell a story about a person who's lying to themselves than to tell a person about someone else who is assessing that person, if that makes sense.
It does. So what's a day in the writer's room like on the morning show when you're dealing with like real serious personal, you know, you're talking about characters that have serious personal issues and shortcomings. And like I said, these messy relationships, I imagine you guys are all laying it out on the table. What's that like?
I mean, it depends on the day. Sometimes we're just doing blue sky plot, you know, and then we're just pitching out, you know, kind of big plot pieces. And other days you are, you know, going in and trying to take apart, you know, an emotional scene. that part I think is, has always been easier for me. So I think that I think actually the mechanics of weaving everything together, shaping it into an episode, shaping it, that is really what we take so much time in the room to do, and make sure that it all feels meaningful and that nothing feels just gratuitous, that nothing's just, this is here to get us from point A to point B. I think it's mostly digging, you know, it's like just looking at everything and constantly digging and testing it.
When you are putting those, the plots together and the stories together, are you a big whiteboard up? Do you have index cards? How are you?
I'm a card person. I'm of the school of the index cards, and I can't give it up. It's like, I've done it 20 years now, and it's very comforting to me to even just psychologically to see all the colors of cards and know that there's a story shape up there.
Well, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So, on a show like this, how are you approaching this each individual episode versus the season? Because this is a streaming show. This isn't, you know, necessarily like a tune in next week when this happens. Like, so how do you approach that as a writer, as a showrunner, as a creator?
I mean, first of all, you look at the big picture story that you're trying to tell, like beginning to end. What is the big story? And I try to really distill that into maybe a paragraph in my own mind so that there's a simplicity to it and a clean, like it's clean. And then you take each episode and you break down, okay, what part of that big arc has to happen here? And then you also go through all the characters' arcs, you know, you kind of map those out a little bit before. So then you have all these big pieces to play with. And then you start, when you get into an individual episode, shaping an episode based on what you need to have happen there. And, you know, you have to sometimes change something in an arc because it doesn't work for the shape of the episode. So you kind of always have to be flexible. You always have to, there's a lot of moving parts constantly. But that is also part of the job and the skill. And, you know, that makes it fun.
You mentioned a little bit, some of the members of the cast. It really is a murderer's row, down to the smallest part. And I'm just curious, you know, obviously you have the leads of the show that you want to serve, but you know, how do you find that right balance of, like, you know, not wanting, just being fair to all of these characters, because you've got so many amazing actors there who can do so much with so little. How do you find that balance?
I don't always, to be honest, because it's a huge cast and I spend a great deal of time, being very hard on myself because I couldn't give this person this great scene because there wasn't room, because I ended up having to, you know, to cut for time, you know, time and length and budget are realities. It's a lot of great, greatly talented people. They're all fun to write for. They're all amazing. You know, they can all deliver it in spades. And so it's just, it really is like you kind of have to always be as true as you can to the story you're telling. And sometimes that unfortunately means you have to like cut a great character scene or a great character story, but it always hurts. And I always wish we had more time in every episode because it's a gigantic cast. Mm-hmm. They all deserve great greatness.
One of my favorite things about like the first season of a show is watching, like, once you get three or four episodes in, you start to see that the writers reacting to the performances that the actors were giving, and sort of, you know, I feel like the actors and the writers sort of find the characters together. And, you know, on this show, I feel like by the end of the first season, like the Billy Crudup character, I was just, you know, I watched a whole show just about him. And I'm just curious what that is like, what your working relationship is with the actors when you're finding those characters together.
I mean, it really is. It's a marriage of sensibilities and artistic talents. And but I mean, it's you know, you pick up different things from people's performances and you feel different things. I tend to pick up a lot of people's sort of emotions and psychology. And so I'll want to like expand that or work with that, or, you know, that will become part of the matrix of the character. it's a very cool process, actually. And it's very collaborative, even though it isn't always verbally collaborative. Sometimes it's literally just being in the same space together, mm-hmm. you know?
So this is, if my research is correct, and correct me if I'm wrong, this is the second show you've been the creator showrunner on, correct?
Yeah, I was a co-creator showrunner on the previous one, which was Bates Motel.
Well, can you talk about that a little bit? What was
I'm
it like?
I'm not technically the creator of the show. I developed it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But you are the showrunner, right?
I mean, the whole created, this is a long conversation, but yeah, I just didn't want to be, you know.
No, I appreciate that.
But my credit is developed by.
I'm just curious, what is your approach, you know, or what are the differences for you? You know, obviously there's a lot more responsibility when you're running things, but having worked on so many other shows before you were in that position, What are the skills that you think you picked up along the way that have served you best as the person in charge?
Well, there's a couple things. I mean, I think just fundamentally, I'm good with story and shaping story and characters and being able to live inside of a fictional world and answer questions about it, like that I don't always know, because it's not like it's all written. It's a feeling and an idea, and I'm pretty good at keeping that going. I like to make sure everyone is taken care of and feels like they understand what they're doing, that they're into it. I like to feel like I'm inspiring people. I like to feel inspired by them. I really enjoy the creative process, and I think I'm fairly good at it. The harder part of the job for me, and the part that definitely I had to work on more at the beginning, is the more managerial part, because I'm very good. Creative people are very sensitive. And so then you have to go into this other, put this other hat on where you're very tough. And people can be tough in all different kinds of ways. But you have to be, you know, a little hard. And that was a little more of a learning how to balance those two sides was hard. And then also just the responsibility of it is a commitment. Like taking the responsibility of all these human beings, their careers, a network, launching, all this money. It's a huge responsibility. And you want to, you know, I just am a person that wants to do the best job I can in any job I've ever done. So I live with that responsibility 24/7. And that can be hard.
I would imagine so. It's a lot of people depending on you. Again, correct me if I'm wrong. So I was looking at your IMDb, and between Bates Motel and The Morning Show, you wrote an episode of a show.
I did. I worked on Rise for.
So what's that like when you go from being the boss to just, you know, a hired gun? Is that just like, you know, fun?
It's funny because there was two reasons I wanted to do that. One was it was Jason Kadams, who I worked with on Friday Night Lights and Parenthood, and who I adore and just love working with. Like I was so excited, and it was a show about high school theater, which I love. And then the second part was I really want, having had the responsibility of running a show, I was really interested to go back and see what it felt like to be doing the other part of it, where I was just in a room, I was helping with story, I was doing a little producing, but nothing, you know, that wasn't a huge part of my job. And I wanted to see, like, wow, can you go back to this? Can you, like, what does it feel like? I was in a human way, I was very intrigued by that question. I just wanted to experience it. But primarily it was because of Jason.
Yeah. Like a little science experiment for yourself.
Oh, that, yeah.
Can you talk a little bit more about Jason? Cause you've worked with him on three shows.
Jason was the first working with Jason. I actually met him on Boston Public, and he came in, I think I was there about a month, and he came in to replace, I think David, Kelly had just handed the show over and was stepping back, and he brought Jason in to run it. And I had never met Jason or worked with him. And within like a week, it was such a sensibility match. I had never up to that point worked with someone that I was like, I completely get this guy's sensibility. I get what, and he got me. And it was just a really wonderful working relationship from that point on. And I felt, I mean, in a lot of ways, I think it was the first time I felt really seen as an artist when I worked with Jason. And I think he definitely helped me flourish and become more confident in my own voice and my own sensibility, because up to Friday Night Lights, really, I had been sort of trying to, the 80s and 90s were different television, you know? And I was trying to always take my sensibility, which was a little odd for what was on then, and try to shove it into those and make it work. And I did okay. I mean, I had a decent career, but I didn't really feel like I had arrived home until I worked on Friday Night Lights.
So let's jump back a little bit then, now that we're kind of getting there anyway.
Yeah.
How did you first start out as a writer? Was it in high school? Was it in college? Was it before then?
Yeah. I mean, it was when I was little. My sister and I had a club called the Show Club, and we would have meetings in our garage and do plays with the neighborhood kids. And I would write plays, and I would, you know, a lot of times they were adaptations of folk tales or fairy tales or whatever. But I was fascinated with entertainment. I don't know why. it was like a thing I had to do. Storytelling was a thing I had to do. I remember writing a play and like a couple times in elementary school and begging my teacher to let me perform it. I don't know. As a freak, I don't know. It meant something to me.
So how do you translate that into, you know, take us from, you know, that to how do you eventually translate that into a career? Do you study it? Do you write plays? Do you study theater?
I did study play. I wasn't in the theater department at UCLA, but all the people I hung out with were in the theater department. So I love theater, and I spent a great deal of time in the theater department and watching theater and studying it. And I took playwriting, like a minor in playwriting with Professor Rhodes. You know, then when I graduated, I was close with Richard Matheson's family. He's a science fiction writer, an iconic science fiction writer, and just a really kind man. He was kind of, I spent a lot of my growing up teenage years at their house. And I was very close to their family. And he suggested that I try writing a script because I was an English major. I graduated from college and I had no idea how I was going to make any money. And he helped me get started. He helped me get an agent, and that was, you know,
that's a good mentor to have, Richard Matheson.
Yeah.
So one of your first credits, it might be actually your first credit is for The Jetsons. Is that?
Yeah, that sounds right. Yeah.
So what was, you've worked on, like, going through your IMDb was kind of crazy because you've got The Jetsons on there, you've got Moonlighting.
Yeah.
How do you go from The Jetsons to Moonlighting? What's that journey?
That's just you knocking on every door trying to get a job. I mean, there was 3 years there of just trying to get a job and not getting a job, you know, and writing spec episodes of stuff and trying to get into meet people and, you know, all that sort of traditional stuff that people do to start careers. And animation then I remember was a little more of a accessible, like you could get into pitch there a little bit easier. And this was a reboot of The Jetsons. And I knew the show from a kid, you know, being a kid and watching it. So I was actually kind of excited about it. And also I had like no money. I was like zero money. So like
excited about that.
I got for The Jetsons was thrilling to me. And then Moonlighting was just right place, right time, luck. It's like luck and opportunity and being prepared. It's like all those corny things you hear. Mm-hmm. It's like it all met up in Glenn Caron's office. And I just, he, that show just had a sensibility that I got. It was really, I don't think people remember this about the show, but Glenn, there was a whole like Beckett aspect to that show, which was that Glenn, I think at the time he had an overall deal or whatever, but he needed to write a detective show. And in, you know, the '80s, a detective show is very sort of, you know, cookie cutter kind of thing. Not that there weren't really good ones. I mean, Rockford Files, like there's a lot of great ones. I'm not saying they're not, but it was a very, you know, specific genre. Mm-hmm. And so he went in and wrote this one, but in the back of his head, he was like, these characters know their characters in a show, but he didn't say that. Like, it wasn't in the first episode, but in the fourth episode, David Addison just breaks the fourth wall. And there was that kind of like crazy, surreal quality to it, combined with genuinely, you know, funny dialogue, great character scenes, entertaining, good mysteries. It was a very ambitious show. And I just loved it. I got it. It was like right place at the right time. I often say if Moonlighting had been on, I don't know if I would have a career, because I didn't really fit the other shows that were on. You know, that show was just weird enough that it worked out.
I'm just curious. So you also written a couple of features, but you've gravitated mostly towards television. Is that by just because those were that's where the opportunities were, or is that where your heart really lies?
My feature experiences were not stellar. I felt like you have no control over how something gets made, and I wasn't really at all happy with how they got made. And God bless everyone who worked on them. And it's like, I know we're all doing our thing, but that was very frustrating to me. And TV, the other thing about features is it was a very relaxed schedule. And it can go on forever, and you can be writing the same movie for 5 years. And I like the thing about TV is I sort of like the immediacy of it, you know, that it's you got to go in there, you got to do it, you got to go. That's a little more exciting. But I would love someday to have a really great feature made. Mm-hmm. I would love to do that. You know, who wouldn't?
Can you talk a little bit about, you know, you just said, you know, you really like the immediacy of television, and you, like we talked about previously, you've worked on streaming shows and, you know, network shows. Mm-hmm. Just talk about for you what the real differences were, you know, you're in a room now and you're crafting a season of a show kind of from scratch, and you're thinking about the season. I imagine when you're working on something like Moonlighting, there might be some consideration to the larger season, but mostly you're dealing with a mystery of the week.
Well, because that show had a lot of character story in it, especially in terms of Sybil Shepherd and Bruce Willis's arc, you actually did have to think about it a little. You had to look at the big picture of where you were going with them. But aside from that, you definitely did have to come up with a mystery week. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so what is that, you know, for you, talk someone who, you know, you mentioned you really like to dig into characters and stuff.
It's hard. It was hard. I mean, that was like one of the first, you know, opportunities I got to pitch for a mystery. And it was stressful because it just wasn't my background at all. So I did a lot of crash course watching Hitchcock. Reading mysteries, just trying to get my brain into that mindset. I did okay, like, you know, but it definitely was not like second nature to me. It was a big challenge, and it was very stressful.
What's your, as a writer, what's your process? Do you wake up super early in the morning to do stuff? Do you give yourself strict deadlines? What do you do?
I am a big deadline person. I hate the idea that I am keeping anyone waiting for anything. I wish I was a little bit less so. I'm not an early morning person. I was while my kids were growing up because you have to be, but I'm not naturally, but I do like to work in the first half of the, in terms of writing and kind of having to go into that trance that you do to like get inside another world. Like I would rather do that when I'm in the first half of the day, like between like 9 and 2 than between 2 and 7. I definitely have a little dip in creative energy between like 2 and 6.
And are you, I mean, obviously in television, you're outlining a lot of stuff ahead of time, but by the time you get to writing the episode, but are you someone who really needs to have every scene figured out, every beat figured out before you go into pages, or are you just,
I actually like to have open room to shape things as I'm writing them, because I feel like otherwise you don't make discoveries as you're writing. And I think there's nothing more boring than knowing exactly what you're writing. It's like, why do I even need to be here? Like, someone else could do this. You know, it's like the joy of finding things in it when you're writing, I think, is what excites me.
Mm-hmm. So right now, obviously staying at home because of what's going on. Is there a virtual writer's room for you guys for season 2?
Yeah.
How's that going?
I mean, it's weird. We're all adjusting to it. It's definitely not, I personally cannot do 8 hours on Zoom. I just can't. So we've done more kind of one-on-one stuff or individual work at home assignments, you know, that I'll then take or use, or, you know, it's just become a little bit of a different process really, but so far so good.
Yeah. So one last thing I like to ask everyone is, you know, and you're someone who's had a really varied career from the 80s through now. Is there something you've learned along the way, or some things you've learned along the way that you wish you knew when you were starting out?
Yeah. I wish that I knew that everybody does not know what they're talking about. I was very young when I started out, and I didn't have it. And it's not like I went to film school. I had no real production experience, or I really was making it up as I went along. And I always assumed everyone who was giving me advice or telling me this is a good idea or this pilot is a good idea or not, I wish that I hadn't really listened quite so hard. Because what you find out is that you're the only person who really knows what you're trying to do. It's like, and until it's written, other people can't always see that, you know? So that was something, I mean, I guess boiled down, that really is about just believing in your own sensibility and trying to always vigilantly explain it. Like, you have to be open to notes, but I think I didn't understand how important communication was. I think I thought like, oh, well, I'm thinking this idea and I'm telling them that idea, so they're going to get, we're thinking the same idea. And that is so not the case. And I think one of the things that I learned, especially with show running, is constant communication. It's constant. Here's what we're going for. This is what this should feel like. This is the overall feeling. And once you start doing that more, it just becomes so much easier, I think, for everybody to get on the same page, you know? So I was a little bit like thinking everyone was psychic. So I wish that it had not taken me so long to learn that.
I love that. Well, where can everybody watch The Morning Show?
On Apple Plus TV. Is that what it's, I guess, what it's called? I know. Apple TV. I count the
Apple TV. It's Apple TV Plus. But we'll put the right one in the description of the episode where people listen to it.
I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you so much for your time.
Yeah. Take care.
Take care. Thanks again to Kerry Ehrin for coming on the show. Season 1 of The Morning Show is now streaming on Apple TV Plus. You should definitely check it out. This episode was produced by Kayla Guess. Editing and post-production done by Sadie Dean. Music is by Santiago Arias. Thanks again, everyone. Until next time, right on.